Hey y'all. So we're going to be diving back into chapter 5 in the book Women Who Run With the Wolves today. And I wanted to recap on a little bit of what we've already talked about. And hopefully I can get through this without coughing my head off. I'm getting over a little cold, so just bear with me. My voice is a little crackly and deep and odd, so that's what's up. I'm actually much better today though. So you know what, when I'm going through this book with you all, I think I mentioned already before that you know, I only read the section that I'm going to be presenting to you ahead. I don't read further along, because as I'm learning and processing the details, and that's just it. This whole book is so rich with details. I'm afraid if I read through an entire chapter and then I for time's sake break it down, presenting it to you, you know, in multiple videos for one chapter, I'm afraid what will happen is I'll pull information from the end of the chapter as I'm explaining the front part, and in reality it's just a process that needs to build in our minds to really grasp the full depth of the lesson. I hope that makes sense. So but in doing this, I think sometimes we can, as we're reading the chapter, we can think that we understand what's going on, and then and have this base level understanding of the points that she's trying to make, the author. And then as we get further into the chapter on this the particular topic that's presented in the chapter, I think that in the end our perceptions and our grasp of the lesson may change a little bit. So really my whole point in this is to give you things to think about, and just to take it from there. And so, because it's not uncommon for me to read a book to feel like I have an understanding of the whole book, and then as I experience, you know, different things in life, it's kind of like now I have a new lens to look at everything through, and then suddenly this book that I've read has a new meaning for me. And that's exactly what has happened for me with this book here. So I actually read this for the first time. I was either in my teens or early 20s, and I wound up reading it twice throughout my life, but it's been a long time. So this is my third time reading it, and and that's exactly what's happened, because I had to have certain life experiences for this book to really, really click on a deep level and to make sense to me. And so I knew that I was at this stage of my life where I needed to pull this book back off the shelf and go through it. And I'm just doing it with you all, and I hope that it's benefiting you as well. So like I said, I want to recap before we move forward into chapter 5 and in the new sections we haven't gotten to yet. And what I want to recap on is this. Grasping the symbolism of Skeleton Woman is not simple. And I know that, let me just say, I found, I think it's an out of print book about the story of Skeleton Woman on Amazon. And so, like I said, I think it's out of print, but I think that the meaning that you can pull from this story of Skeleton Woman can be different depending on who you are. So when I'm reading these things to you, this is the author's lens that we're looking through. And there's times when I'm reading her book and I feel like, yes, she's making excellent points and I agree and it resonates with me. And then there's other times when I'm reading through and I'm trying to grasp what she's saying, and I'm trying to relate it to my understanding in life and my experiences, and I'm trying to make the best of it and pull something good from it. And then sometimes I can look back and I can say, hang on a second, I don't know about that, you know. So that's what's happened at this stage so far. So there's statements she's made about Skeleton Woman and what she represents that really resonate with me, and then there's other things that are mentioned that don't resonate with me. And I just realized I hate this. I think it's not very attractive for my videos. I'm gonna flip it. So it's kind of out of the way, hopefully not distracting us any. So, but I want to go back to, if you have the hardcover copy, it's going to be on, let me make sure I'm at the right place. Yes, it's going to be on page 147, okay? And it's the third paragraph down. It says, I'm sorry, the fourth paragraph down. It says, what is the not beautiful? Because remember, skeleton woman represents the not beautiful, okay, in ourselves and in others. So here she's trying to define what that is, okay? So it says, what is the not beautiful? Our own secret hunger to be loved is the not beautiful. And it's kind of like, why is that not beautiful? Because I feel like we're born into this world, a baby even, you know, is desiring its mother's love. And so you can break down each one of these things like that. Like, is that really not beautiful? Or like, yeah, of course that's not beautiful. Some of these things, I think definitely, they're like narcissistic traits, you know, like that right there, that one statement. Our own secret hunger to be loved. The fact that it's secret, our secret hunger to be loved, almost sounds like desperation. And if you're keeping it a secret, then that's a motivation to be manipulative to someone. I feel like whatever your desires are, when you're approaching, and this whole chapter is about a relationship, a partnership. And I feel like anytime you're approaching another person in that dynamic of a relationship, you need to be straightforward. Nothing should be secret. There shouldn't be a secret hunger or desire of any kind. I think everything should be, you should be totally open and honest. So the fact that there's even, and she calls it the part of the not beautiful. So, you know, you can break it down like that, okay? I don't know, just some things to think about. And then she says, our disuse and misuse of love is the not beautiful. Well, of course, that sounds awful. To disuse and misuse love. I mean, that's such a broad statement. And, you know, again, the lens I'm looking at all this through is narcissism, this book. And so that's absolutely what narcissists do. They present this facade that they love you, but their actions don't match. And so they do use your love and your compassion and all the good qualities in you. They use that to their advantage. And I'm going to wrap this up with my point in just a second. Let me go ahead and read the rest of this part here, because this didn't sit well with me. Our dereliction in loyalty and devotion is unlovely. In other words, if you're wavering in your loyalty and your devotion, yeah, of course that's unlovely. That's awful. If you can't commit to a person, you know, that's not ethical. It's again, it's just right along with narcissistic traits. These people cheat all the time. They can't, you know, they live hidden secret lives. It's just, let me keep going. Our sense of soul separateness is homely. And that's kind of like it could go either way as far as ethics, you know, soul separateness. A lot of people feel like a narcissistic person who is just living completely false behind a facade of lies, they're clearly cut off from a soul kind of quality like empathy and compassion, right? But then on the other hand, it's kind of like when you're the victim of narcissistic abuse, you can also feel like you're cut off from your soul or your spirit, that life force, because it's been sucked out of you. So it's that one can kind of go either way. But she's calling all this the not beautiful. Our psychological warts, inadequacies, misunderstandings, and infantile fantasies are the not beautiful. So, yes. So, that kind of sums it up right there. To me, it comes down to this. We should never accept, because the moral of this story is to not reject skeleton woman. We're supposed to be compassionate with her, not run from her, no matter how scary she is, because she represents the challenge of facing the not beautiful in ourselves and in others. Well, if you're talking about a narcissist, I don't think you should accept that. I don't think you should get comfortable with that, and you should be okay with that. So I just want to put that out there. And I'm not saying that's what she intended here either. This was just through that lens, kind of the way I'm looking at this. And I just wanted to make that statement, because when it comes down to it, you have to consider a person's, I made notes on this earlier, and of course they're on my phone, so I can't pull them up because I'm recording with you all. but you have to consider a person's motive, their intentions. Their intentions are motives. Because sometimes you can see a person show, display, act out whatever, something that's not beautiful. And it's like, where is that dividing, decisive line or point where you say this is acceptable, like the story's trying to get us to see with Skeleton Woman, versus it's not acceptable and you just got to walk away from this person? Where is that line? And I don't think abuse is ever okay. Let me just put that out there. But I think that line is where their heart is, their intention. Because if someone is truly unconscious and unaware of their behavior, they're going to be wanting to grow and wanting to, and you're going to see this, not just wanting, but you're going to see a person, you can tell the difference. And I think that, like, for me, and I don't want to make a statement for everyone, but I feel like maybe when you're young and relationships in general are new to you, I think that you just don't have that level of discernment to be able to tell someone's true intentions and where their heart is. But as you get older, you can tell. And so what happens with narcissists is they try to get us to buy into their excuses, when in reality, if you step back and you look at it, you know, without them like this in your ear, and you can think for yourself, then you start to say things like, you know what, I wouldn't do that. Even though they're saying it was a mistake, whatever it was, or they didn't know that it was wrong, or they didn't know it would hurt you, or they, you know, it was a mistake, whatever. You know, I've always been like, well, would I have done that? And if it's like, no, because I live by this code of ethics, you know, then it's hard to make an excuse for someone like that. So it's just something to think about. I don't think that all mistakes are the same. I think that what it is narcissists try to get us to buy into, when they are caught, with all their different, very unethical tactics, they get us to buy into the fact that it's a mistake, when really it's not. It's intentional. It's just they got caught. And so I just want to put that out there. And then she said some beautiful things about Skeleton Woman too. And because this is where, you know, being willing to sit with and accept and learn Skeleton Woman within yourself and within others, I think that applies to healthy people, healthy and ethical people, because none of us are perfect. So in that regard, through that lens, I think this is very applicable to the whole moral of the story, to accept Skeleton Woman and not run away. But you gotta be able to know, what's that old song, when to hold them, when to fold them, when to walk away, and when to run. You know, you gotta be able to discern, is this person, is Skeleton Woman the way it's presenting in a particular connection, relationship, is this a situation where you should walk away or run or not? And so you really got to sharpen that discernment to be able to tell if someone is just simply perfectly imperfect, but, you know, but trying and living via, truly living through their actions via a growth mindset, versus someone who's just making excuses left and right and you never see any changes. And the things they're making excuses for are things that actually benefit them, and the behaviors are manipulative and deceitful and things like that. So I never want to make an excuse for something like that, because I don't believe in those things. I don't think there is an excuse for those things. Those things are a choice and they're intentional. And that's my two cents on that. So, I just wanted to bring that up. Okay. So, the next section is called The Sleep of Trust. And if you remember last time, towards the end, I think, you know, she was talking about the difference between, innocence versus ignorance. And ignorance is where, she says in the book, that ignorance is where you don't know anything. You know, you're just very naive that you choose the good. But then innocence is where you have come in contact with the darkness and you understand how it operates in the world, which is that awakening that happens after you go through narcissistic abuse or and or entanglement. And then you walk away with this new knowledge of the darkness, but you still choose the good. Because the thing is, a narcissist couldn't be lying and manipulating and using people without the knowledge of this. So they made that choice. They were made aware of it, just like you were made aware of it, as you woke up from just blindly trusting people, giving people the benefit of the doubt, right? You woke up from that. And well, the narcissist at some point woke up from that, because you know, we weren't born as an infant with this information, with this knowledge, this awareness. And so they made the choice to use it to their benefit and live very unethically and use people. And so when you wake up from it, you know, I guess we have that same choice. I can't imagine making the choice a narcissist does, but I guess whenever a person does, you know, wake up to this awareness, it is a choice. But you know, healthy, ethical people are, of course, not going to choose to do what just happened to them. But it goes from you being ignorant to being innocent, because that's what the book's saying, that you're now aware. You're no longer naive. You are aware, but you still choose the good. And so it just reminded me of that verse in the Bible that talks about we must become as little children to enter the Garden of Eden or heaven or paradise. I can't remember what the verse says exactly, but so I'm really curious about this next section here. So I hope that you'll hang with me, and I hope that this is very interesting for you too. Okay, y'all, so this is kind of deep stuff, and I'm just going to be reading quite a lot from this part of chapter 5, The Sleep of Trust, and we're going to have to do some processing together, okay? So hang with me. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and reread to you. I believe I read this first paragraph of this section in the last video, but I'm going to read it again just so that it's fresh on our minds. So again, this chapter is called Hunting When the Heart is a Lonely Hunter, chapter 5. And then this section of chapter 5 is after the story of Skeleton Woman, called The Sleep of Trust. In this stage of relationship, a lover returns to a state of innocence, a state in which he is still awed by the emotional elements, a state in which he is full of wishes, hopes, and dreams. Innocence is different than naivety. There's an old saying in the backwoods, ignorance is not knowing anything and being attracted to the good. Innocence is knowing everything and still being attracted to the good. And then she goes into talking about sleep and how it's regenerative and what it means and how trust comes into all this. So it says, while the metaphor of sleep can denote unconsciousness, here it symbolizes creation and renewal. Because remember in the story, Skeleton Woman, the fisherman goes to sleep, right? And that's when all this stuff happens. Skeleton Woman, you know, takes his heart out of his chest. Lovely image. And she's beating on it like a drum, and she's, you know, coming to life. So it says here it symbolizes creation and renewal. Remember, it's all symbolic. Sleep is the symbol of rebirth. In creation myths, souls go to sleep while a transformation of some duration takes place. For in sleep, we are recreated, renewed. Okay, I'm going to skip a little bit. This state of wise innocence, remember, not ignorance, is entered by shedding cynicism, which is so hard after you go through hard things, and protectionism, and by re-entering the state of wonder one sees in most humans who are very young and many who are very old. It is a practice of looking through the eyes of a knowing and loving spirit, instead of through those of a whipped dog, the hounded creature, the mouth atop a stomach, the angry, wounded human. Innocence is a state that is renewed as one sleeps. Unfortunately, many throw it aside with a coverlet as they arise each day. It would be better to take an alert innocence with us. Alert innocence. With us, and draw it close for warmth. Though the initial return to this state may require scraping away years of jaded viewpoints, decades of callous and carefully constructed bulwarking, I hope I'm saying that right. Once one has returned, one never has to pry for it, dig for it ever again. To return to an alert innocence is not so much an effort like moving a pile of bricks from here to there, as it is standing still long enough to let the Spirit find you. It is said that all you are seeking is also seeking you, that if you lie still, sit still, it will find you. It has been waiting for you a long time. Once it is here, don't move away. Rest. See what happens next. This is the way to approach the death nature, not as wily and shrewd, but with the trust of spirit. The word innocent is often used to mean a person of no knowing or a simpleton, but the roots of the word mean to be free of injury or hurt. So I view this as ignorance is before you go through these hard lessons in life, before you've been entangled with a narcissist, you're ignorant of it. Innocence is where you now have this awareness of the darkness in the world, how it operates, how damaging it is. You're wounded, you're hurt, right? But you have to do the work on yourself, on your discernment, on trusting your intuition, realigning yourself with that inner guiding GPS, that inner guiding light, if you're a spiritual person. And you're never going to operate again from the viewpoint of giving people the benefit of the doubt. You're just not going to do it, because that's part of that earlier stage that you lived, where you were, you know, very naive. And so when she talks about the returning to this innocence, it wasn't it so poetic? I love to read her work. But it's like, now you have this knowledge, but you're choosing to not trust people per se, but you're choosing to trust yourself from the viewpoint of your hard-earned new wisdom and your refined discernment. So it's kind of like you're no longer blind. Your vision has sharpened greatly. So it's like you have a little bit of a foundation to stand on here. And so that's how I view this. She says the roots of the word mean to be free of injury or hurt. So to me, you're not even going to consider another relationship and trusting another person enough to the point of truly connecting the way it should be in a healthy relationship until you've gone through this process that people go through as their world is shaken up from narcissism, and they have to get back in balance, they have to get realigned, and feel confident enough in their own judgment with all the new stuff they've learned. You know, that's all got to come first. It's all got to come first. Otherwise, you know, you're at a high risk of being taken advantage of again. So I view all this as, you know, something that's only possible, really, after you have that wisdom that comes from going through these hard things. That's how I see it. Prior to that, it's just ignorance, you know, an innocent ignorance. By way of this metaphor of innocent sleep, the fisherman trusts the life-death-life nature enough to rest and to revivify in her presence. He is entering into a transition that will take him to a deeper understanding, a higher stage of maturity. When lovers enter this state, they are surrendering to the forces within themselves, those that have trust, faith, and the profound power of innocence. In this spiritual sleep, the lover trusts that the works of his soul will be worked in him, that all will be as it should be. This lover sleeps the sleep of the wise instead of the weary. There is wariness that is real when danger is near. Again, you're not going to be going through this process in a relationship with someone until after you've cleared them through your discernment and feel good that they're not a narcissist. You see what I'm saying? That's really, really important. I don't think this is a process right here we're reading about that you would, a path you would even start down if you haven't cleared a person, you know, in your mind from your experiences and said to yourself, I'm pretty sure this person is a healthy person, a true person, a person who believes in honesty and is and does not live by deceit and lies. You've got to clear a person from all that first. So I think all this process right here that she's talking about is about a true good union between good people, honest people, non-narcissists. You see what I'm saying? There is wariness that is real when danger is near, and wariness that is unwarranted and that comes from having been wounded previously, which is understandable. The latter causes men, and I would say women as well, to act touchy and disinterested, even when they feel they would like to display warmth and caring. Persons who are afraid of being taken for a ride or of being trapped, or who vociferously, I don't know if I'm saying that right, state their claims over and over again of wanting to be free, are those who let the gold slip right through their fingers. I'm going to read a lot of this just so we can absorb it. Many times I've heard a man say he has a good woman who is enamored of him and he of her, but he just can't let go enough to see what he really feels about her. The turning point for such a person is when he allows himself to love even though he has pangs, even though he is nervous, even though he has been wounded previously, even though he fears the unknown. Sometimes there are no words to help one's courage. Sometimes you just have to jump, but I would say not blindly and not quickly. That's my my interjection there. There has to be at some point in a man's life a time when he will trust where love takes him, where he fears more being trapped in some dry, cracked riverbed of a psyche than being out in lush but uncharted territory. It reminds me of a comment I heard someone say that really stuck with me, which is, is it better to just stay with what you know, even if it's bad, like the devil you know, or something like that, versus, you know, the unknown. Something to think about. When a life is too controlled, there becomes less and less life to control. In this stage of innocence, the fisherman returns to being a young soul, for in his sleep he is unscarred. There is no memory of what he was yesterday or before. In sleep, he is not striving to gain place or position. In his sleep, he is renewed. Within the masculine psyche, there is a creature, an unwounded man, who believes in the good, who has no doubts about life, who is not only wise, but who also is not afraid to die. Some would identify this as a warrior self, but it is not that. It is a spirit self, and a young spirit at that, one who, regardless of being tormented, wounded, and exiled, continues to love because it is in its own way self-healing, self-mending. Women will testify to seeing this creature lurking in a man outside of his awareness. This young spirit's ability to bring the power of healing to bear on his own psyche is so awesome that it is astounding. His trust is not dependent on his lover not to hurt him. That's important. His trust is not dependent on his lover not to hurt him. His is a trust that any wound that comes to him can be healed, a trust that new life follows old, a trust that there is deeper meaning in all these things, that seemingly petty events are not without meaning, that all things of one's life, the ragged, the jagged, and the lilting of the soaring, all can be used as life's energy. And so she talks about women next, and you know that it's a similar process for women. You know, we have our own work to do. It says, when both are well initiated, they together then have the power with which to balm any hurt, outlive any pain. And I mean, that's a lot. That's a lot to absorb. But again, none of this, in my opinion, I don't think she intends for it to be viewed as blindly jumping into a relationship with someone, a friendship with someone, an intimate relationship with someone, a close partnership with someone who you haven't vetted, Does that make sense? Like, because now you have this wisdom, and that's a beautiful thing. It's a good thing to have this awareness, even though it sucks how you got it. But, you know, it's good. I think that the vetting process has to happen. But let's just say you've done the vetting process. I think that's, at that point, that stage is what she's talking about. Because even if you choose not to get super close to another human being ever again, I mean, that's your choice. And it's not that it's a bad choice whatsoever, but to totally disengage with life to the point that you're on the couch all the time, you know, I think that that's not where real life happens, you know? The richness that life can offer you. It's like I think she's encouraging us, because she specifically talks about after being wounded. I think she's encouraging us not to let life come to a halt, to trust in that cycle, that there is, it's life, death, and then life again, that there's more life to be lived. And so that's the beauty of this. And that's what I'm pulling from it so far. I'd be curious to know your thoughts if you feel called to share. And then she gets into the next section. Let me take a look at the time. Okay, so we're already at 30 minutes, a little past 30 minutes for today. So I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up. And we'll start the next section of chapter 5 in the next video. And it's called Giving the Tear. Remember how when the fisherman went to sleep, he had the tear roll down his face. And the skeleton woman drank and drank and drank. And it was like a river for her. And she was replenished. So I'm looking forward to that too. And I just hope that you guys are enjoying this process. And if you enjoyed this video, I would appreciate it if you gave it a thumbs up. I think it helps to put it out in front of other people on YouTube as they're looking for what they need. And so also, if you feel called to subscribe, that'd be great. And you can always hit the bell to be notified when I post new content. Thanks so much for coming along with me, and I hope you guys have a wonderful day, and I will see you soon.